Thank you very much for coming tonight. On behalf of the Humanities Institute and the TILTS program of the Department of English, I welcome you to this special lecture by Dr. Rita Charan. I am Pauline Strong, Director of the Humanities Institute, and Dr. Charan is the ninth distinguished scholar, artist, or activist to hold the C.L. and Henrietta Klein Centennial Visiting Professorship in the Humanities. Each year, the Humanities Institute collaborates with on-campus and off-campus partners to bring a distinguished guest to campus as the Klein Professor. And this year, we were absolutely delighted to welcome Dr. Rita Charan. She is the second physician scholar to hold the Klein Professorship, as Dr. Paul Farmer was our guest in 2013. At that time, UT was just beginning to envision its new medical school, and Dr. Farmer helped us think about the importance of social medicine in addressing health inequities. This year, as the Dell Medical School enters its first year of existence, Dr. Charan is meeting with faculty, staff, students, and community members to help us think about the demonstrated value of narrative medicine and the medical humanities more generally. The Humanities Institute has chosen the theme of health, well-being, and healing for this year and next. So this will be the first of a number of public lectures on this topic. Please pick up a Humanities Institute flyer and sign up for our mailing list when you leave the lecture hall in order to be kept informed about our future events on this theme. As I already mentioned, this evening's lecture and Dr. Charan's visit to UT are co-sponsored by the Texas Institute for Literary and Textual Studies, or TILTS. TILTS, a program of the UT Department of English that receives important support from the Office of the President, has chosen Health, Medicine, and the Humanities as its 2016-2017 theme. TILTS will be sponsoring a number of events related to that theme throughout the year. You can pick up a schedule of the year's events immediately outside the lecture hall and also sign up for their mailing list. The schedule provides the TILTS website address where you can find additional information. Most immediately, the Literature and Medicine Symposium will occur this Friday from 9 o'clock to 4:30 at the AT&T Conference Center in room 102. There will be four distinguished speakers, including Rita Charan, and the schedule is available on the website. An event of this nature relies on the support and hard work of many people. Professors Philip Barish and Brian Bremen, co-directors of TILTS for the current academic year, wish in particular to thank Dr. Elizabeth Cullingford, chair of the English department, for her support of their efforts. TILTS and the Humanities Institute would also like to thank our professional staff, including Melissa Biggs, and our student assistants, Wendy Fernandez, Peter Khalil, Alejandra Martinez, Sarah Lynn McKinnon Crowley, Thomas Wynn, Cole Werl, and Lily Zhu. And we are also very grateful to our partners at the Dell Medical School for helping to publicize this event, which we hope is only the first of many common endeavors. Like you, I am anxious to hear Dr. Charan, and so with no further ado, I would like to call on my friend and colleague, Phil Barish, to introduce my new friend, Rita Charan.
Hi, everyone. As Polly said, I'm a professor in the English department and a co-director of this year's TILTS. It's both an honor and a pleasure for me to introduce Dr. Charan to you tonight. I'm going to be as brief as possible in order to leave maximum time for Dr. Charan's presentation and for the Q&A that will follow. Keeping the intro short is a challenge because of the magnitude of Dr. Charan's accomplishments and the significance of the recognition she's received for them. Dr. Rita Charan is professor of clinical medicine and the founding director of the narrative medicine program at Columbia University's College of Physicians and Surgeons. She received her MD from Harvard in 1978, and then while practicing as a general internist in New York City and teaching in the Columbia Medical School, work that in itself would more than exhaust the time and stamina of most people, she decided to enter Columbia's English PhD program, from which she graduated in 1999 after writing a dissertation on Henry James, himself a challenging writer. I just want to read you a few sentences that Dr. Charon wrote about the experiences and processes of thought that led her to return to graduate school for a literature PhD, and ultimately to found the field of narrative medicine, an approach that has been embraced by medical clinicians, medical educators, many other health professionals, and others, both within the US and internationally. Dr. Charon describes herself as sitting, just after she finished her internship residency, in a small clinic room in Presbyterian Hospital in New York City, and encountering patients, many of whom she tells us, most of whom she tells us, were, quote, poor, sick, elderly women of color from the Dominican Republic, Puerto Rico, Central America, and the American South, who now lived in Manhattan's Washington Heights or Harlem. She realized slowly, she tells us, that perhaps the most important of her tasks as an internist sitting with these patients was to develop, quote, the skills required to absorb my patients' multiple, often contradictory, stories of illness. I came to understand, she writes, that what my patients paid me to do was to listen expertly and attentively to extraordinarily complicated narratives told in words, gestures, silences, tracings, images, laboratory results, and changes in the body, and to cohere all these stories into something that made provisional sense, enough sense, that is, on which to act. What I was listening for and reading for were diagnostic clues to help identify a biological or emotional source of the patient's symptoms, autobiographical background to help me understand who it was who bore these symptoms, and what grounds there might be for personal connections between the two of us sitting in that room. I'm just going to read a little bit more, and then I'll turn the floor over to the person you're all waiting to hear. In order to do all of these things at once, I had to do what all doctors ideally do, whether they realize it or not. I had to follow the patient's narrative thread, identify the images or metaphors used in the telling, tolerate ambiguity and uncertainty as the story unfolded, identify the unspoken subtexts, and hear one story in light of others told by this teller, end quote. These are precisely the same skills cultivated, of course, by literature, by literary studies, and by the humanities more generally. That's the insight that brought Dr. Charon to an English PhD program. Ever since then, Dr. Charon has been on a mission dedicated to helping her colleagues in the health professions, colleagues both current and future colleagues, to recognize the utter centrality of these skills of listening, reading, and telling stories, and how deeply important these skills and these acts are to all of us as patients, as care providers, as teachers and students, and as human beings. The importance of Rita Charon's work has been recognized by numerous honors and awards, really too many to list. She received a Guggenheim Fellowship, a Rockefeller Foundation Bellagio Residence Fellowship. I think she's probably one of the few people alive who has received major grants from both the NEH, National Endowment of the Humanities, and the NIH, National Institutes of Health. She is the author of Narrative Medicine, Honoring the Stories of Illness, published by Oxford University Press in 2006, the editor of several important anthologies. She is co-author of Principles and Practice of Narrative Medicine, which is forthcoming in November of this year, 2016, again from Oxford University Press. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Rita Charon to the University of Texas.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Thanks very much. I hope you can tell in what Phil and Paul and Polly said that I've been having the best of many worlds. And because I was privileged enough to be able to sit in this little room in Washington Heights, and I've been in that same little clinic since I got there in 1981. And the privilege has been all this time to be able to take in what it is that patients trust me enough to tell me. And this has been the fire behind all of this work to make sure, perhaps, that others who are in the position to care for the sick and care for those who might be well and want to stay well, that we can all more and more accurately and with excitement listen, absorb, realize the importance of all that a patient may say. Things are never routine. There is always surprise. There is never certainty about what a patient may be saying, about what the listener may be experiencing. Instead, when it's done, well enough, when it's done well enough, you can never do it perfectly, these clinical conversations become deep expressions of self and the shared work at hand. So when Phil reads, this is something I had written back in 2006 from this last book, and I was kind of interested to hear it again, and it's still true, that edge of your seat, what is going to happen next, and am I going to be present enough to register it? It's there all the time. So I'm going to talk with you some about presence, about attention, which is one of the hallmarks of this kind of work, and about the kind of affiliation that can come about gradually with a commitment on the part of the listener toward capturing as much as can possibly be captured of what that teller tells. Now, I came here, I had one non-negotiable requirement when they asked me to come to Austin, and that's that either on the way in or on the way home, they would bring me to Houston so I could go to the Rothko Chapel. Now, do you know the Rothko Chapel? Yes. Well, you guys are so fortunate that it's only 2.5 hours away, because I think if I lived here, I'd be there at least once a week. It's for those who haven't been there, it's kind of an octagonal wall with benches in the middle and paintings on all 8 sides of this wall. It is dim light. It's quiet. Even if it's full, it's quiet. And the paintings of Rothko, here's one. This one's not in the chapel. This is another one. This is called Blue, Green, Brown. This abstract expressionist painting, this was done in 1952, for some reason tells me about what it feels like to be sitting in great attention in front of a patient. Now, Rothko understood that his job, I'll read you how he calls it, his job as an artist, like poets and philosophers, he says, is the expression in concrete form of our notions of reality. He simply thinks that it's his task as an artist to show what he sees so that others can join him in that reality. And in the chapel because you're surrounded by this effort. And it's very abstract. Is there a plot in this painting? Is there a story here? Could somebody tell me what do you see? What's it about? What do you see?
I see an opening. I see a place to go.
A place to, indeed. Is it into the blue, into the green?
Into the dark.
It's do you see it's into the composition? The saturation of colors is pulling you in. Now, why did I pick on this man? Because he's leaning forward and so looking at the painting, I could tell. Do you see? But it's not like this is a house and people doing things. There's no plot. There is instead an experience. Yes? Some of the paintings are very dark. Some of them have very little light in them. But I just want to express to you why it is that this attitude of summoning us in to a very mysterious, kind of ambiguous reality is what we try to equip our doctors, our nurses, our social workers with, this sense that we are humble in the face of a patient. We do not master what a patient has or needs or wants to say. We are humble. It's a narrative humility to do our best to look at a patient knowing nothing that we can assume and letting that patient gradually teach us about his or her situation. That's the cover for the book coming out. Right? Do any of you know how many months it took me to get permission from the Rothko estate to put that on my book? You see, but it was worth it. So, however wacky it sounds, this abstract painting taught me something about my medicine. And it taught me the need for letting myself be summoned out of my ordinary self toward this mystery. Rothko himself writes about putting up with or tolerating doubt, not knowing what's going to happen at the bout of a painting day. And that kind of doubt, I think, is critical for the work of the artist, for the work of the scientist, for the work of the clinician. The work we do, I called it narrative medicine. I didn't call it the medicine of doubt. I guess I could have, but that would have been a little chancy. I called it narrative medicine to remind us all that our work is saturated with stories. There is not an act of teaching one does as a clinician, practice, research, that is not loaded with and enacted through stories. If you listen around in a hospital, you'll hear people saying things like, "I had this guy once." That's how we think about our own knowledge. Sometimes people get upset when they hear us talking like as if people are reduced to their organs. What do we do with the liver in X? It's not to be condoned, but it is a very telegraphic way of telling stories. It's not to be condoned, and we holler at people when they do that. But it is this very instant telegraphic way of saying, you know and I know, and we don't have to tell all of the words that are concentrated right there. And so the effort in narrative medicine was very simply to find ways of teaching young doctors, mid-career nurses, physical therapists, chaplains, all of the faculty, in all of the departments, teach them skills that will allow them to absorb stories, because stories are not simple things at all. One doesn't measure them. One doesn't extract from them the necessary facts. Instead, like Alice Munro says about short stories, you enter them. Alice Munro, the Canadian woman who recently got a Pulitzer. No, it was a Nobel. She says, when I read a story, it's not like a road I travel from beginning to middle to end. She says, it's like a house. I enter a house and I look around and I get a sense of what the rooms are like and what goes on in this place. What are the rules of this house? I'm a guest in this house. And that's how we try to encourage our clinicians to listen. They're a guest in this house. They're not there to tell people how to live in their house. They've been invited in. And when they're in that home of the story, they're then able to humbly, not with mastery, look around and absorb its meaning. And when they do that, they're in a position to be helpful as an ally for that patient who's come for some help. Now, some of Rothko's paintings are darker than blue, green, brown. This one, to me, looks kind of somber. The purple and the black are kind of colors of mourning. And I'm reminded to say that the stories that we hear in caring for the sick are stories of gravity. They're stories of sadness, they're stories of suffering, they're stories of loss. And although sometimes people get better, and indeed there's lots of joy in the work, I'm reminded that what illness does is to raise the veil on very important aspects of life that are oftentimes hidden. That illness lifts the veil on persons' lives. It is when gravely ill that people ask themselves, who do I love? Who loves me? Where is home? Where do I belong? These are questions that become evident in illness. Those of us who work in intensive care units know this most dramatically, or in palliative care. The veil is lifted, and all of the things that are left unsaid, the secrets, the envy, the desire, the regrets, become very evident. And we then, as the ones helping to care for patients, are the ones who have to understand those things. The ones who have to be comfortable in the face of deep regret and loss and anger and rage, all of these come when illness lifts that veil. I'm going to tell you a story about a patient who has given me permission to tell it. It's a very simple story. It's very simple, I think. But it helps to explain what I'm trying to say. So this was a woman, she was 44 when I first met her. She came to my clinic for the first time after having been to many, many clinics to care for her very bad diabetes. She had been diabetic since childhood, and she had been in and out of hospitals too numerous to count. She had very dangerously low blood sugars, very dangerously high blood sugars, had been in comas because of her diabetes. It had terrible complications with her skin mostly, not yet her kidneys or eyes. And she had not been able to gain control of this diabetes. And she comes into my office. She was beautiful. I remember she was beautiful. She had these very fancy glasses and fancy fingernail polish. And clearly she was very attentive to her appearance. But she comes in, and I started the visit as I normally do, which is to say, I will be your doctor. Please tell me what you think I should know about your situation. And I've trained myself not to say any more than that, especially on a first visit. And so she told me about all the complications she had had, and she was enraged. There was rage in her, rage at the disease, rage at her doctors, rage at her body, rage at all she had lost. She wasn't working. She had worked in the past, but now she wasn't working. She was at home. And she's kind of spilling rage, and I make sure to roll my chair away from the computer, just put my hands in my lap and listen. And at a certain point she stops talking in the middle of this rage. And she looks tearful, and I still don't say anything. And then she breaks her silence. She says, "All I want is a new set of teeth." And diabetes can give you bad gum disease. And she had lost her teeth. And as she was talking to me, she was kind of covering her mouth. And she had no teeth. She had had a denture made by Medicaid. The denture didn't fit. It gave her blisters. She couldn't wear it. So she was 44 years old and toothless. This is why she stayed home. She wasn't able to go out. She had no social life. She had no sex life. She had a business she wanted to start but couldn't. All I want is a set of teeth. So all we did for the next 2 or 3 months is work on getting her a new set of dentures. And it took, we got together, we ended up being kind of conspiring together because we would compose these letters to Medicaid saying what would happen if she didn't get her dentures. And she'd be with me as I'm calling friends of mine in the dental clinic. And we kind of made our way to get her back on the list, and sure enough, we got approval for her dentures. She comes back within maybe 6 weeks and is beautiful and has her new teeth and is beautiful and is able to smile. And now, this is a long story, and I'm sorry, it's not a spectacular story of great medical rescuing, but it shows what happens if you come in humbly, not knowing what's most important. And she just out and told me, because I asked her, what was most important. And once that happened, we became co-conspirators, and we had managed to do this thing that was so important for her. And so it became much easier for her to organize that she was on two different kinds of insulin and a couple of pills and aggressive kind of physical therapy and diet therapy. But she was able to control her sugars. She had a reason to. She started the business she wanted to start. She got a partner. She got a job. And it just stays with me as an icon of what can happen with very simple interventions. The intervention was what? Tell me what you think I should know about your situation. So that's the kind of, how can I call it? It's small scale, common sense, nothing fancy, desire to be there, attentive, to be summoned, like these paintings, into the narrative world of patients. Now, I've spent all this time touching bodies, listening to the sounds they make, taking stock of the bodies of patients. Everyone except psychiatrists and psychoanalysts who are in healthcare touch bodies, inside and outside. And we know that our bodies are part of what, they're not separate from us. Our bodies are ourselves. And there is no one on earth, there is no one on earth who has exactly this one. This is mine and only mine. And each of us lives in with this body that is they. The philosophers Judith Butler and Adriana Cavarero talk about how critical it is that as we become ourselves, we are able to expose ourselves, that we are seeable, visible within our bodies as ourselves. And that's another thing that we clinicians, we didn't know that we could do that for patients, but indeed our very witnessing of their bodies exposed is part of an important stage in persons getting to know who they are. But at the same time, and I talk about being in a body as one of the conditions. It's one of the conditions of being human, isn't it? We are human. We have bodies. We are mortal. We will die. These are the conditions. We can't renege any of them. But being in a body detaches us from others, doesn't it? Because we are enclosed, and we are, by that definition, separate. So this is one of many, many divides that occur. Now, I just told you a story about a time when a patient and I made some contact. But in many of the cases, the clinician and the patient have many divides to overcome. They're divides of gender, language, race, class, ideas about health, ideas about bodies, ideas about what will help disease, so that it is, I'm going to show you some pictures of divides, because I think as we talk about ways to improve healthcare, as we aspire to be able to make contact with patients through the stories, through the attention, through the witnessing, we have to be aware of the things that we must overcome. Now, this is a Salgado, Sebastião Salgado photograph. He's a Brazilian photographer. And I look at this river, this silver river in the valley. And on the west side of the river, I see rather sloping, gently sloping hills. And I see on the east side of the river much steeper cliffs, yes? So we doctors and patients, clinicians and patients, may live on the same landscape, but we're faced with very different steepnesses, where the patients are having to scale the steepness of illness, whereas the doctor on the gentle side is in a body, but is not being challenged by it. We're in the same body, but we're not being challenged by it. Now, there's another kind of divide. This is a cell. This is a picture of a cell with many of the organelles inside it. And within that one cell are all kinds of metabolic, enzymatic, chemical reactions going on that help the cell to do its work. I show it because there's a neighboring cell, the one right on top of it, or the one here to my side of it. I just want to remind you that each individual cell is entire unto itself, and yet is influenced by its neighbors. And those of you who study molecular biology and cellular mechanisms know that one cell can transmit messages to the other cell, that things, water, ions, salts, can move from one cell to the other. So instead of being divided, this is a symbol, this is an example of separate things that are permeable and that can influence one another. And this is a much better example, I think, of what we're hoping for between a clinician and a patient. We are separate in our own bodies. We are similar in that we are mortal. And yet, we are permeable so that a patient's mood can enter me so that I understand that mood. Hopefully, some of the experience and knowledge that I have can permeate to the patient. Perhaps my sense of optimism for their outlook might permeate. Perhaps some things that are unsaid by the patient, I might somehow kind of receive in transmission, do you see? So that the ideal of being permeable is I think, a very important one. Now, this is not permeable. Where do you think this is? It was taken March 2015. Where do you think it might be? Could be Guantanamo, absolutely. What else?
Syria.
Could be Syria. Yeah, I mean, they're too numerous to count. Could be Mexico. Could be Palestine, Israel. This one happens to be the border between Greece and Macedonia when the Syrian refugees were stuck. So a reminder that sometimes these divides are unscalable. That I may show you some modest divides. I may show you some pictures where on different sides of the divides there's some movement. But we remember that sometimes they're immutable. And this happens in healthcare. People are turned away. People can be turned away for care. It happens rather regularly that the first question to a patient seeking a new appointment with a physician or a nurse is, what kind of insurance do you have? Polly told the story of Paul Farmer, who had a child in Haiti who needed expert care, and Paul Farmer managed to helicopter that patient to the mainland and then to a hospital who could take care of him. He was asked, well, you can't do that with every Haitian child. What are you doing? And he says, right now I'm caring for this Haitian child. Now, that's not a health policy. That is a moral ideal. So I put this up to remind us that there are many as yet unscalable divides between persons who need care and persons who can give it. And the clinics we have in cities for the uninsured are nowhere near adequate to be able to give the care that is necessary. And there are many things that cause divides. I'm talking about economic divides. There are many things that cause divides, attitudinal divides. It is very hard, for example, for transgender people to receive the care that they need because of prejudice and bias. So we keep in mind that these divides are there. This is the Green River in Utah. I found it Googling Windy River. I wanted a picture like this that could show that the east side of the river and the west side of the river are the very same landscape. And if you travel over to parts of, in one of the real, I wish I had a clicker. Do I have a? Yeah. In here. So we're on the west side of the river here, but look, if you go all the way over here, are you on the east side or the west side? Right? And the same from here. You're on the east side, but you go all the way over there. So that's kind of an ideal for me, for the person who's sick and the person taking care of that person, to realize that they're territories are fully interdigitated, that they are not on separate sides of a river. Look at them. This is how we are. We don't know that. And as we do this work, it becomes clearer and clearer that the more we can consider ourselves as being on the same terrain. We are human, we have bodies, we are mortal, and we will die. The more we can understand that that is the case, the better will the care be. It is a way of achieving existential parity with patients. They are perhaps more acutely ill than we, but we, those who care for them, will have our turn. This is hard for healthcare professionals to understand. We tend to have a magical fantasy that because we're around illness so much, we get immune to it. We do. We feel that we will never die, that we will be immune. If a doctor gets sick, it's very, very hard for his colleagues to know what to do. And they tend to ignore and stay away from the sick physician because somehow that's breaking the rules. See? So I love the Green River, and I was flying home from California, and I'm in one of these planes that have, you know, some of them have very fancy GPS things that you know exactly what you're flying over. And I'm flying, and I see what looks like this really windy river. And it was very clear, and don't you know, it was the Green River. It was the Green River in Utah. This picture I found in Google, and I'm flying over it, and it's luscious. It looks just like that. So remember this. Remember this Green River as a metaphor now for those of us caring for patients to be in parity with them. And even though at any one time the patient will be in more existential distress, and when I say that, I mean the distress of realizing that their lives are limited and may or may not have meaning, and for us to realize that we too are in the same fix, just maybe slightly at a different time. And it's when I've been able to be with patients in their facing of their death that I come to understand that I too will die. And it's a tremendous revelation. And it's the patients who have been able to show me that. And once that happens, you're able to care for patients without fear. This is Cezanne's card players, right? He's got a whole series of them. What do we got? Two guys sitting at a table? What's the mood here? Do they look relaxed? Do they look ambitious? Do they look what?
They're focused on the game.
They're focused on the game, absolutely. Yes.
I was just going to say the same thing.
They're playing a game. It's two guys playing a game. High stakes, low stakes, what do you think?
Low.
Low, kind of relaxed, right? What about this one? Yeah, darker, right? The guy on the left looks kind of sinister. Same place, same bottle of wine. We can see the cards a little bit.
Yeah, we're closer in, they're more...
That's right,
that's right. The faces are clearer, so you can see the emotions more.
And what are those emotions?
Like intensity and focus.
Yeah. And the guy on the right, I'm sorry, I interrupted somebody. The guy on the left is kind of in the dark. He's got the dark hat. The guy on the right is more illuminated, looks a little more baffled. But I've seen both these paintings, and Cézanne says that he paints, and he paints them over and over. He has a whole series of these card players. And he painted them in honor of the workers in his father's farm in southern France. And he says, in the same way that he paints the mountain over and over and over again in the south of France, Mont Saint-Victoire, he paints it over and over and over again. He found that painting these workers on his father's farm gave him the same sense of rootedness, groundedness, timelessness as painting the actual land itself, that they were so essential to his sense of reality. Now, Merleau-Ponty, the philosopher, says this about Cézanne. The artist is the one who arrests the spectacle in which most men take part without really seeing it, and who makes it visible to the most human among them. I think that's what we do. I think clinicians, I think doctors, nurses, social workers arrest the spectacle in which most men take part without really seeing it. It's a reminder to me that our task is to be able to see what it is that's taking place and to in some way capture it. Cézanne captures it in painting, I may capture it in language, but in some way to take stock of the, it doesn't always look dramatic, but it is exceedingly dramatic because it's the person who has come for help, whatever it's for. So the notion of arresting the spectacle helps me to convey my sense of what attention is. So let's say that our task is to behold the situation of patients. Now, Phil told you in the introduction how I figured out early on when I was taking care of patients that that's what I had to do, was to really get the story that they were telling me. And it was not easy at all to do for someone who was not trained in listening carefully to how things are told. Medical school didn't used to teach us that back then. And what I didn't know at the beginning is it wasn't enough to listen, that I also had to in some way represent what I heard. This is what the artist does, that he represents what he sees. And so part of narrative medicine from the beginning was not only attending to what patients say, but also giving form to what they said. Mostly writing, but also our program includes visual art, dance, music, performative, performing arts. There are many ways to represent, to confer form onto your perception. I learned later that just according to aesthetic theory, Nelson Goodman writes that he says, he's talking about perception, perceiving anything very simple. This microphone, we're perceiving it, and you perceive it from up close, he's perceiving it from farther away, you can barely see what I'm pointing at. For me, it's very close. And here's what Nelson Goodman says. When we perceive an object, we perceive a version or construal of it. So we each have our version of this microphone. When we represent that version or construal, we do not copy it, we achieve it. See? So if we were to draw what we see, if we were to describe what we see, we would be achieving it. And without that representing, it would go away. We would not have access to what we perceive until we give it some kind of form. So this explains our practice in narrative medicine of teaching people very close reading, close listening skills, but also insisting that they write or that they paint or that they in some way represent what they see because it's only in the representing that we gain access to what we see. This is why, although I don't think this is why it was done at the beginning, this is why we doctors and nurses write everything. We have to write it down. And if the clinicians in the room will holler about the electronic medical record and now we can't write the way we used to write, I'm with you. But even if you're keyboarding, you're representing. You're writing something. And it's in the writing that we come really to understand what we know. So as we developed, and what happened was at Columbia, I then, once I was in the English department, and once I got to know some of the English professors, they started coming up to the medical school. And they would come up. I would ask one of them, could you come up and teach Toni Morrison's Beloved? And they would, and they'd come up. And they started to realize that the medical school and the hospital was an interesting place to think. That there were interesting problems, and that there were people up there who wanted to know what they, as literature professors, knew. So it became a kind of easy traffic back and forth. And I was going down to graduate seminars, but they were coming back up with me to teach my colleagues. And that gradually developed into a very committed group of people from literature, creative writing, philosophy, psychoanalysis, oral history, patient advocacy, and then pediatrics, family medicine, internal medicine. And together, we essentially taught one another from our own fields and developed principles, really, of a form of practice that we then called narrative medicine that included creativity and doubt, both of those. The creativity to see fully what is in front of you, to let yourself be surprised by what you see, to not assume that you knew what you were going to see, but instead to realize always the profound doubt in which you move, that there is no certainty, that there is no sense that you will come to totalize or know fully what another person needs. It was a challenge within medicine because, of course, we depend on our certainty. It's very hard to do something in medicine if you don't feel absolutely, positively sure that this is the right thing to do. And so we all create we create more certainty than there is in our minds. In order to act, we have to. And so what we were doing was a challenge to say that foreign things like creativity and doubt were really necessary within medicine. Now, these were some of the principles that developed from that work. We started from the beginning wanting very simply to recognize what people said, to absorb, to let into ourselves what persons were saying, with the sorrow or the anxiety or the fear that that might bring. Of course you have to interpret. Any two listeners will have a different version, just like when we're looking at things. And so, of course, we have to interpret, and we have to realize that ours is not the only interpretation. And then that we have to be moved to action. It's not enough to sit and listen. You have to be moved to action on behalf of the person who's telling you something. Otherwise, it's solipsistic, and it's just for yourself. So these became our guide points. It emerged, this field, from a combination of primary care, which is ordinary outpatient medicine, longitudinal, get to know your patients, and narrative theory, that together they form what we eventually call narrative medicine. The relationships, of course, are central. And these are relationships that can go on for decades or can unfold in a matter of hours in an emergency room or a matter of days in a hospitalization. It's not restricted to the old GP who's in the same town forever. But the relationships is where the permeability takes place or where the razor wire can occur. Huh? Phenomenal, just reminding myself and you of the actual sensory, perceptive experience of one person for one person of another. That this is two people in a room at one level experiencing one another as the phenomenologists describe it. And that the kind of clinical knowledge that we want to develop is highly sensory. I went out of my way to say, except for psychiatrists and psychoanalysts, we all touch our patients a lot. It is the necessary sensory level of the intimacy that happens in the healthcare. The co-construction, we know that if I'm listening to a story, I will not hear the same story or the same story will not emerge as compared to another listener. And we do exercises of one person telling a story to two listeners and then the two listeners write down what they hear. And it's always very, very different. And we have to admit that. And we have to appreciate the gravity of our own role in co-creating that which is told. And it is the case that a patient who goes to Dr. A will leave with a different diagnosis than if they went to Dr. B. It is the case. I'm not saying that there's no such thing as certitude and testing and evidence. I'm not saying that at all. But the ways in which these stories unfold will emphasize certain things and not others. So that gives us all the more responsibility as we do our best to listen. And commitment to social justice is always there, because we know, especially in this country now, that the opportunities for the best health possible are not equally shared. And so this must be part of the work. There are many places where if you pay a bonus of $6,000 a year, you get boutique care. Do you have that around here? Boutique medicine? With like these concierge. Yep, I'm using the scabrous word. They do call it concierge. I don't think we can suffer that. So the commitment to social justice is very much there. Now, I've told you already about these three movements, attention, representation, and affiliation. I just want to show you some pictures that depict them. This is Salgado again. And this is a Tuareg woman in northern Sahara. She's partially blind. And as she looks out from that frame, I hope you can experience this. I don't know if it's dark enough in this room. But she is the only thing on earth. You get that sense of absolute focus. And, I mean, she's looking at Salgado. I mean, he's there in front of her with his camera. But the intensity with which she's looking out from the black just reminds me of the ideal that we strive for, that this person is the only thing in the world right now. And other distracting thoughts and things you have to do and phone calls you have to make and the grant is due fall away to achieve this intense, inalienable focus on the patient. That's the kind of attention. One can develop this. One can train oneself to have this kind of attention. And those who, mindfulness and meditative practices and contemplative work, I think that's why the Rothko trip was so necessary for me. So that there are ways to train ourselves to put aside other distractions. And when we do that, this is a very big lesson for doctors and nurses who feel burnt out and fatigued and discouraged and why am I still doing this? When you're able to practice with attention, there is a tremendous buoyancy. You are there doing absolutely what you must be doing. There's a buoyancy. There's a Richard Seltzer, the novelist, calls it the black joy of practice. Because it doesn't mean that you're not seeing suffering, but that you're seeing it in a way that you're doing your best to make it better. Uh-oh. I might need your help, Polly. I don't know. There we go. Thank you. So this is another. Thank you very much. That was very expertly done.
You are.
So here's another River by Salgado. This one appeals to me because it's very ambiguous. We all see a river. We see it forking. In the mid photograph, we see herds of something, some little herds of something grazing. These guys, there's some up there. But what's at the top of the picture? Describe what's at the top of the photograph.
Clouds or trees.
Yeah, clouds or trees. Which?
Yeah.
Do you see the ambiguity? Sometimes I think they're trees, sometimes I think they're clouds. And so he represented this view in a way that simply didn't decide for the viewer, is it trees, is it clouds? He could have, maybe, but the mist of that day prevented it from being clear. And so it's a reminder for me that we don't always know sharply what it is we're representing. When the young diabetic came in, I didn't know at the beginning what I was even perceiving. Was this just a really angry woman who had given up all hope? Or it was like the sun rose when she finally said, I want a new set of teeth. I said, ah, we can do that. You know? So at the beginning of that visit, I couldn't have represented. I would have, in my mind, I was representing it this way. I didn't know. And I think that's what I'm trying to teach people, is don't make up certainty if it's not there. Show the ambiguity. Show the doubt. This is a photograph of doubt. See, now it's not. Here, let me try this. Wait a second.
You see that little arrow down at the bottom?
Yeah, no, but it's not working.
It's not helping.
This is, if you can get the cursor there.
That's bad.
Oh, no.
Wait a minute.
No, they're together.
There we go. Now.
No.
Okay. Let's just start over. Excuse me, folks. It's very weird. If anybody thinks they're good at this, feel free to come up and help me, because I'm not. Okay. We want to go to...
Go right there. Down here.
But is this the one you want?
No, I want
no,
that one.
This is the one you mm-hmm. want. Okay. Okay.
Right there. Right there. Right here.
Play from... Presenter view, you think? And we'll...
Okay, let's now see if this works. There we go. You did it.
Thank you.
Excellently done. Thank you. See, you know more than you think, Polly. So what are these guys in the boats doing? I think they're poling. It's like a shallow, right? They have poles and they're pushing against the bottom of the river. It took me a while of looking at it to see that they're coming toward us because the wake of the boat is behind them. And I like it because there's two guys in the boat. And each one I can see looks like he has more than one. Is it ominous? Are they fleeing from something? Is it a new day? What's the mood here?
Coming home after a long day?
Could be. It could be coming home. Yeah. So mist, mysterious, ambiguous, not sure you want to be there.
They don't look like they're in a hurry.
There we go. Yeah. So this one, because there's at least two in each boat, makes me think that they're not alone. And the final movement of narrative medicine, attention, representation, and affiliation. So that there is never nothing we can do for a patient. There is always something that can be done, even if there's no medical or surgical or chemical intervention possible. We never say there's nothing more to do, because we can always accompany people to where they're going. And this notion, and I don't know if they're going away from something horrible or not, but it's a reminder to me that you never give up, that there is always a task. Now, my last name is Sharon. It's spelled C-H-A-R-O-N, and it's the name of a figure in Greek mythology. Anybody know it?
Sticks.
Yeah. So I'm named after the boatman who rows the boat across the River Styx to Hades, and you cross the River Styx when you have died. So I'm the one who carries you over the river after you've died. This is not a good name for a doctor. And the first man to recognize it was a 26-year-old man. He was in the Beth Israel Hospital in Boston. And he had a cancer of the liver, a malignant cancer of the liver. And he saw my name tag. We had red name tags. And he says, "So this is it." No, he was very ill, and he died in a few days of a big pulmonary bleeding. And I was determined to change my name. I thought it was horrible that I added to his suffering. And Boston City Hall, it got very complicated. I didn't change my name, in part because there were two Dr. Sharons before me. I realized that it was a name I had to live up to, that that was my task, and that I had to come to know this river very, very well. That was my task. And that I had to somehow accompany. I had to know the shores, the currents of that river. And I had to be with those who were taking their last journey. So I'm glad I didn't change my name, and I continue simply to try to live up to it. Now, I'm going to close with a group of representations of a different sort. These are done by a painter, a Swiss portraitist and landscapist, Ferdinand Hodler. His young wife, she was in her early 30s, soon after the birth of their daughter, developed ovarian cancer and became very sick very quickly. And he, as a painter, as an artist, did what he could do, which was to represent her in her suffering. So I'm going to close with a series of paintings of Hodler bearing witness to the suffering of his wife. The Youth. The Illness. The Exhaustion. The Pain. The Agony. The Last Painting, and she's now dying. And Sunset Over Lake Geneva. Thank you. So I think we have some time for questions if we want.
Yes, ma'am. I am a recreation therapist and a storyteller. I work with people that are trauma survivors. Mm-hmm. I've worked in state hospitals and prisons. I wanted to talk a little bit about, you talked about co-creating. I do a lot of that. I actually work with a lot of the people that I work with in them telling their own stories, mm-hmm. orally, sometimes written, but sometimes actually orally. You talked about the lady who wanted her own teeth, and you sort of apologized because you said she didn't have a spectacular medical solution. That kind of fits in with the orientation I come from, is basically that there are three kinds of illness narratives. The redemption narrative, and that's the one that I call the Disney-fied narrative,
right. Mm-hmm.
The one in our Western society,
right,
where we think that everybody has to be sick, and then you have to be well, mm-hmm. and everything has to be lollipops,
right.
and roses, right?
Right?
And I think most people in our society, they think they have to buy into that,
mm-hmm.
and they don't want to even tell a story if they haven't got that
mm-hmm.
ending to tack on to the end of it,
mm-hmm.
right? The one that I try to help my people realize they can tell are the chaos and the quest narratives, the chaos narrative.
This is great. So,
Can I just explain what those are in case people don't know what they are? The chaos narrative, where, of course, you can go through chaos and yet maybe you can learn something and something good can come out of it. And the quest narrative, where you strive for something, but maybe what you learn along the way might be even more valuable to you than the thing that you quest for, even if you don't even get the thing you quest for. So I just wanted to know what the value of doing that is with a patient.
So this is great. So our partner is talking about the differences in how persons might experience their illnesses, and is very wisely guarding against the need to make everyone tell the same story. That there's no illness narrative anything like your own. And persons do feel kind of pressured to tell a story that has a good ending. Or we pressure them to tell stories that have good endings. Or perhaps persons can come in this culture to expect that there will be a good ending. And we have to disappoint them. Because we are human and we have bodies and we are mortal and we will die. So, but the distinctions are very, very important. I think there's not just three kinds of illness narratives. There's an infinite number. And we don't need to put persons into categories that are not adequate. But it's the necessity that it's the necessity to tell them fully. And when you started talking that you're working in trauma, it's even more important because there are many stories, there are many accounts that are indeed untellable. And they remain untellable. We worked with the Fortunoff Archive of Holocaust Testimony at Yale. And we know that many of the experiences in the Holocaust were never told because they remained untellable. Sometimes it means that there was not a listener able to tolerate the hearing. This is true of persons, rape survivors, often cannot find a listener who can tolerate what they have to say. So there are so many complexities. It is not a simple thing at all. Some of my colleagues think it's simple. Oh, go get the patient's story. You say, no. And one reason that we are developing a discipline is to say, no, guys, it's really hard. You need a lot of training to be able to do this well. And sometimes the training we get in clinical disciplines counters the effort that we learn the wrong things in a medical curriculum or a nursing curriculum that we then have to unlearn. So thank you for your comment.
Hi, I'm a student, and I frequently work as an interpreter at a clinic. My question is particularly with, because we see a lot of Hispanic patients, and I'm Hispanic, so I understand that usually religion is a very big part of the culture.
Yes.
And especially with patients with chronic diseases or something.
Yes.
Lots of patients feel that there is some kind of lesson to be learned from some specific type of suffering. And often, I've seen physicians try to push back against this.
Yes.
And because this is such a firm part of their worldview, it can be catastrophic to them to even have this challenged to begin with. So I was thinking about how you approach problems that arise in that type of situation.
This shows the depth. This shows the extraordinary depth of what goes on, even in routine. In routine office visits. It's not necessarily something terribly catastrophic, but this is a clash of worldviews, that the patient with a religious or spiritual meaning-making is going to ascribe meaning, or the lack of it, to an illness, to a phenomenon. And this has to be listened to. This is when Alice Munro says to read a story, you enter the house. Well, this house has to be entered. And I don't, one doesn't have to endorse a particular religious view. And we all, that's one of the divides. I didn't mention that one. But certainly, people of very different faiths are going to be taking care of patients. So one doesn't have to endorse a particular view, but one, of course, can bear witness to whatever faith or meaning can be found in an illness. Imagine if we were to strip away sources of meaning. I mean, for one person, it's religious. For another person, it's relational. For another person, it's familial. For another person, it's a cause, commitment to a cause. And this is as individual as the body you're in, what it is that grants meaning to your life. And this is the search that we're on with patients. So it's shocking that would be denied, that a physician would think it was important to say, no, this is not a source of meaning. It's very sad. I hope you as interpreter were able to help.
Professionally, I'm obligated to just
say I know. You write your letters to Medicaid. Yeah.
Oh, right. I really enjoyed the talk. I'm a student at the community college here, and I came for a sociology kind of extracurricular thing. But I just wanted to comment on the use of art in your talks and just where that came from. And do you use that in your clinical work, or is it just something for your public talks? Or I find it very fascinating.
Yeah.
It simplifies and deepens the things that you say.
Yeah, thanks. In clinical work, I've used writing a great deal, not so much the visual art. But my patients and I write all the time. And when something happens that I don't understand, I may just write a description of a visit. This is what I think happened last Thursday. And because I'm writing it just for the patient, I don't have to write it in the technical language that the chart would require. So I just write what I remember happening, and then I show it to her the next time she comes in. I say, I think this is what happened. Did I get it right? And it shows that I'm trying to get it right. But it's much better than that, because the patient will read it, and typically what happens is they'll make some corrections. You know, no, it wasn't August, it was March. Or, no, Juan is the 12-year-old, Carlos is the 15-year-old, like that. And I was very surprised at the beginning, but then I expected it. The patient would say, we left something out. Reading what I had written, we left something out. And then I would learn about a stillborn, or a death, or histories of abuse,
so that cracked it open.
Suffering, that it made it possible to tell what really needed to be told. But I think, and this was repeated, I think it was because I showed that I was trying. And then in the reading itself, and this is the creative part, in the reading itself of what I had written, perhaps she understood what she had left behind, what she had left out. Not that she consciously didn't say it the time before, but that it became clear that there was a hole in this story that she then opted to fill.
But also maybe subconsciously she knew she was really being listened to.
Well, these are hypotheses.
Yeah.
And then patients would bring me things they had written. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Poems written in jail. I mean, things that meant such a great deal.
Did that inspire them bringing the artwork into the
I think it was the search for the creativity of it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You can. Oh wait, there's someone there.
So I'm an English professor.
Yes.
So it may be a slightly different kind of question, but first I wanted to thank you for such a thoughtful talk and for a talk that was so movingly based in personal experience. I wanted to say, first of all, I'm really convinced about medicine and art and about the kinds of connections that you're drawing. I'm curious, though, about narrative.
Mm-hmm.
I think I understand, or I can imagine, why not dramatic medicine?
Because
I think of all the social science about roles and scripts, and I think that's been done well.
Right.
But I wonder if you have addressed in your work, if you know of people who are addressing, if you might want to address something like lyric medicine.
Yeah.
Right? And how you see the specificity of narrative on the one side or possibilities for like other modes.
Yeah. So you know that narrative is not omnipresent, has many ways of defining itself. And I mean, I know that in some strict definitions of narrative, there would not be any place for visual images. Or there wouldn't be place for poetry. Well, I'm using a very wide definition of narrative. It's narrative versus a narrative or non-narrative. So the definition is a common sense definition and not an English department definition. Although, of course, we use very strict narratological theories and concepts to do the work. But in the naming of it, it was a way to say this is a form of care that makes room for the stories. I like the sound of lyric medicine. It's not a great answer, but it's the answer I can give you. Yes.
Hey there. So I guess I have a question about the relational aspect of mm-hmm. this whole process. So I was just thinking about our question and answer session here. Our room's like half male and half female, but only men have stood up here to talk.
Oh, yeah.
And the men have all introduced themselves.
But that's not true in a second.
Good. Yeah. So, but there's this relational. This guy works for the state hospital. That was important for him to let you know up front.
Right.
That guy's an interpreter. That guy's an English professor. So that guy's a sociology guy who's here for an extracurricular. Like, I'm wondering why that matters, or should it matter?
Oh.
If I'm sitting down with you as my patient, should I just shut up? As a man, I'm asking you.
Yeah.
Do I shut up? Do I let you know who I am and introduce my...
Yeah.
myself into your narrative?
Yeah.
Do I just not do anything and let you talk? Can you talk more about what the provider's relationship and proper perspective should
be? Well, let's think about how you started. I appreciated knowing that you're a sociology student and you're working with trauma persons and that you're an English professor and you're an interpreter. I think that gives texture and meaning to what's going to come next. There are two people with bodies in the room. And so I don't have strict rules about... Some people have very strict rules about patients shouldn't know anything about your family, you shouldn't have your family's photographs on your office wall. I think maybe in the analytic setting, this is very strict, that the whole point of psychoanalysis is that the person telling is the one who is being revealed, and the person listening is meant to be to some degree unknown. But in ordinary medicine, I think the more we can establish parity, that we are not on opposite sides of that river. We have parity, and the patient knows at least what I do. Now, there's no way, I'm not a proponent of self-disclosure. Patients don't come to us in order to know what we ail from or what our illnesses are. There's a black comedy novel about medical training called The House of God. And rule number four of The House of God is the patient is the one with the disease. So the patient's not there to comfort me, although indeed patients can comfort me. The patient's not there to comfort me, but it doesn't mean that I have to be anything less than a person. And the ideal is to form a trusting, workable relationship. Workable. So I don't think there are rules of disclosure. And I think the better we are at this existential parity, the better the care will be.
I always get worried that if you disclose too much too early, you're biasing or limiting the conversation.
Well, yeah, yeah.
Hi, I'm Valeria. I'm a student here, and I've always been really interested in medicine. I'm going to be pre-med, and I've always really been interested in writing, too.
Mm-hmm.
And for a really long time, I was battling between which one I would pick.
Yes.
And today, I realized I really don't have to pick.
No,
that's
you don't.
The idea of, that's why like captioned me to come here was
yes.
Narrative medicine. It's
yes.
something I've never heard of before.
Yes.
Didn't think it existed.
Yes.
I thought I'd have to like make up a major so that I could do what I wanted to do. And so I wanted to ask you, what caused you to realize like that you could combine medicine and writing so beautifully, and how you got on this path, and how to help someone who wants to do a similar path get on it and like just follow the right steps?
You know, I think you're really lucky, because by now there's a path.
Yeah.
but lots of things have happened to open this path up. It wasn't just what we did at Columbia. It is a shift in the ideas about health and about illness and what helps. And the ideas have come from the humanities, from creative work, from social sciences, from anthropologists doing all that wonderful work, just describing the lived experience of patients. So that we know more now than we used to do about the complexity and the individuality of illness. We know that no two illnesses are the same. And we know that the more we understand about this particular one, perhaps the better we can be helpful. So I don't think it's going to be uphill for you. It's not the wackiest idea that a creative person will do well in medicine, nursing, social work. So you don't have to make up a new major. No. And talk to some of the people here. There's a group of... Are you here at the university?
Yes, I'm here. Yes.
So Plan 2 has a group for pre-meds. And we just met with them the other day. And they're all pre-meds, but they're English majors and history. And so there's room. There's room.
Thank you so much. I really appreciated that. So at some level, of course, the practice of medicine has changed, and all of you are pioneers, and it's a new... But I want to focus on this whole issue of listening, and I'll go to my question through a detour.
Yes.
You have a colleague in anthropology at Columbia called Michael Tosic, who trained as a physician.
Yes.
And early on, his work was on anthropology of health, and he wrote an article in the early 80s when he was doing work at Henry Ford. And it was about basically listening to... There was a story of a patient
mm-hmm.
who had muscular problems and mm-hmm. polymyositis or something, right? And the question was that he would listen, and her thing was that she had done something sinful,
yes,
and it was an affliction,
right?
And she
right.
kept on talking right. about that, and then she had different hours in the hospital in which she wanted to comb her hair, but that's when the nurses wanted to come in and do something to her, draw blood or something,
right, right, right.
And then, but all the so people listened,
yeah,
but the. But that's the other side of it, and I want to hear how you are managing with
yeah.
the other side,
yeah.
where everything had to be done because evidence-based medicine
right.
or the logistics of a contractual system or soap or what have
right,
you, right?
Right, right.
Treatment has to be done in a certain efficient way and a productive way,
okay.
right? So even everyone listened, she had to be fitted into this kind of mechanism
yes.
through which efficient medicine
yes.
could work.
Right, right,
and
right.
I think that is a challenge that you and your
right.
colleagues do have.
Right.
And I think
right.
that is after this very important
yes.
shift that you, and in other, in OBGYN,
right.
the idea of birthing and
right.
you know, all kinds
right.
of stuff have come in. I mean, we have incorporated
right.
Midwifery and all that
mm-hmm.
kind of stuff. But yet, there is a certain power dynamic.
Yes.
And the challenges that people like you
right.
have in this field are also interesting, you know, because how does one deal?
There
I mean, in
go.
Your case, it may be different, but
right.
in many cases, it's
right.
very much that kind
okay.
of medicine. So
exactly.
listening becomes a tool of getting something so that we can better inject them, from,
right.
you know, whatever.
Right. So a very eloquently described
yeah.
Depiction of the structural aspects
yeah.
of healthcare, that things have to be done on hospital schedule, and the IV nurses are only on the floor at a certain period of time, and the meal trays only come at noon, and even if you're sleeping at night, we're gonna wake you up for your 4 o'clock vital signs. So that's a collision. And there's not just one person in the hospital, there's 240, or however large you're. So as you're talking, I'm reminded of a new set of nursing homes. They started in the Pacific Northwest. They're called the Beatitudes. And these nursing homes realized that they were putting, and these are mostly patients with advanced dementia in their home, and they were putting these patients on their schedule for their convenience, but they didn't have to. And why should we have more people on day shift than night shift if our patients really sleep on very different schedules? And why should we have the kitchen staff just here at breakfast, lunch, and dinner when our patients who are demented and don't have a sense of typical daily schedules, they get hungry at different times? So they switch the whole thing around, and the kitchen is open all the time, and nobody's going to be awakened for their 7 a.m. bath. And the patients are allowed to freely choose when they want to do what they do. Now, it has been a remarkable success. It has been much easier to staff the home because not everything has to be done all at once. So the baths are given through the whole day, and the kitchen staff is much happier because they don't have to mount these big meals and then do all, do you see? Now, that's a kind of thinking that might be useful in how we run even inpatient units. I think that we tend to be hemmed in by schedules. Think of waiting rooms and clinics, right? So what you're pointing to is a need for lots of creativity and more doubt. We don't have the best way to do lots of things.
And the challenges like people like you face.
Sure. So we must not be satisfied with the way we're doing things now. Whether it's in scheduling people's baths or giving, in some clinics, everyone gets a 1 p.m. appointment. I'm telling a secret. They give everybody 1 p.m. appointments, and people come and they wait. Now, this need not be. There was a big problem because there were patients were piling up in the emergency room, and there weren't enough beds upstairs, and there were 20 people in the emergency room, and it was chaos. This was not at my hospital, this is someplace else. It was chaos, and they were just piling up, and they couldn't understand what was the problem. How are we going to fix this? And this hospital had enough of a sense of teamwork that they got staff from all the possible departments to come think about how are we going to fix this. So the admissions office and the head nurse and the people from the pharmacy were there and the cleaning people were there. And it was the guy from the laundry who says, "We can't deliver the clean sheets until 1 p.m. That was the problem. The laundry had its own drill, and the clean sheets got to the... So the nurses, the people up on the wards were waiting for the clean sheets. We can't accept a new patient. We can't make the beds. We don't have the clean sheets. Now, this is crazy, but this is typical of big institutions. So I think you're pointing to a need for major systemic systems change, that our systems have been calcified and hard to change. The laundry no doubt had a reason for waiting until 1 p.m. Do you see? So everything is to be questioned. Everything is to be looked at with innovators' eyes to say, could we do this better? Absolutely.
You know, I think that's probably a good place. Do we have one more question? Okay. I was going to say everything should be questioned. We could end with that, yes. But let's end with your question.
Sure. Well, my name is Brown Scott. I'm a Plan 2 student as well.
Oh, I just talked about
anyway,
you.
We just had a talk together.
Yeah.
I'm also a student at the Graduate School of Public Health, and I actually did a public health internship this summer in Brownsville. And one of the major things that they try to do there is to really talk to patients about diabetes, about mm-hmm. their weight, about food and diet. And I wondered if you think that physicians have a right or a duty even to not only listen to patients' narratives, but also try to find a way to empower them to craft healthier new ones. Mm-hmm. And if so, how do you walk that line between persuasion and acceptance?
Right. No, I'm not suggesting that doctors just sit there and say nothing. I hope that's not what you're thinking. I mean, I think they should sit there and say nothing for the first 15 minutes of their relationship so that they get to hear how does a patient frame this whole experience of illness. But then they become partners if it works. If they end up two men in a boat with polling, then it becomes very active. And I think we're doing better and not just telling people what to do. You know, it doesn't help very much to say, well, you're eating too much carbs. You're going to have to stop that. No more rice and beans for you. She's Dominican. She's not going to eat rice and beans. You know? Right. So no, the ideal is not you speak, I never speak, but rather to establish a ground where there's not an hierarchical divide. And then to become, like I said, co-conspirators toward finding ways to handle. Yeah. No, I don't think we should remain silent all the way. No.
Thank you.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah,
good. Okay.
Well, thank you very much. And will everyone please join me in a warm round of applause?
Thank you.